I had a strong relationship with reality, and that I like the stories to come from reality, and then step by step we go to fiction.
Hi, Audrey.
Hello.
It's so lovely to meet you. I'm Stephanie. I'm a BAFTA Breakthrough participant, and I'm a composer. So thank you so much for taking the time to sit down with Tea with BAFTA. Do you have tea? Are you a tea drinker?
I must say that it's coffee because I'm French.
There you go. I have espresso as well. So we're breaking all the rules already.
Okay.
Well, congratulations on your BAFTA nomination. Very, very exciting. I sat down to watch Happening, and it's an incredibly powerful film. It's such an honor to be speaking with you today.
Thank you. So
I wanted to ask, and it's probably a question that you do get quite a lot. I read that you started out as a screenwriter and a journalist and have kind of pivoted into directing. So I was curious, how were you able to pivot, and how does your work in journalism influence your work as a director?
I asked myself for a long time if my journey was quite, makes sense, because I did several different jobs. And at the end, being on the set, I realized that all my different experience was helpful. I used to work books also, and I strongly believe that every experience that you have writing help you in a way, because it's exploration. Mm-hmm. And, step by step, you find what are your true interests, what are your topics, what is obsessing you. So I think that also I had a strong relationship with reality, and that I like the stories to come from reality, and then step by step we go to fiction.
Do you feel that all of those experiences are what compelled you to want to tell a story about women's lack of access to abortion?
When I decide to make a movie, I know it's going to take me years, and it has to come from a very intimate part of my story. Or I actually discovered the book, Annie Ernaux's book, short after having an abortion myself. And it made me realize the strong gap in between medicalized abortion and illegal abortion. I thought I knew what it was. And reading Annie Ernaux, I realized that I had no real idea of this journey. So I guess I kept that in mind.
Sure. And how long were you adapting the screenplay, working in pre-production and production? How long from start to finish essentially was Happening?
I made a first version quite quickly. Mm-hmm. And my producer said that it was already something that we could work with. But then I realized I wasn't ready at all. And I asked him to stop the process and to get back to writing. Which I did with the help of Annie Ernaux, and it's very important to me because, like, she can point what's right, what's not, regarding to the period, and I can right. focus on what matters to me, the journey of that body. So it was really helpful to know that she was around and that I was free. And then it was very hard to find the money. Sure. For many reasons that I understand, like the topic is not that easy. Mm-hmm. I really wanted the movie to be an experience, to tell the story through the body mm-hmm. of this young woman. For many reasons, people could say no to the project, but I also felt throughout the journey of the financing part of the process that some people, but they would not tell it that way, were against abortion. Mm-hmm. So it took us a year and a half, I would say.
How did you go about finding your main character? How did you go about casting the actress?
That was something, because I knew that she would be the movie. I mean, she would be in every screen, every second. And I know how hard it is. I wanted to work with a girl who has already made movies, because I knew that the DP would be there the whole time. Right. So close. You have to be brave to do that kind of part. So when I met Anna Maria, it was funny because when she arrived at the casting, she was actually interviewing me. She asked me questions like, okay, I believe that in these seconds I have to be nude, and I understand, but I want to hear it from you. why should I do that? And I was smiling, like inner smile, because I was like, okay, she's already the character somehow.
Right.
And she has something strong, but also mysterious, you know? And the last thing that really mattered to me is that she is playing a young girl studying literature, and someday she'll be a writer. So I needed a girl who would understand the text and who would have a strong relationship with words. Mm-hmm. And we worked together a lot, for instance, on silence. You know, when she's silent, I wrote inner monologues and she rewrote those monologues. So she has always something in mind, something she wants to give to the audience, mm-hmm. like a message, you know. She had many things I was looking for. So surprisingly, to me, it was an easy choice, an easy pick.
Yeah, it's so fascinating hearing about the inner monologue because... Yeah, Anna Maria just says so much with a look. It makes so much sense that you had planned all of that together and that she really took that and sort of made it her own because she communicates so much to the audience without saying anything.
I'm so happy to hear that because those were the strong questions we always had in mind, you know. What can we do with silence, you know? How can we communicate through the body, you know, mm-hmm. the body, the eye, the way she breathes was something. It was kind of a music we used. And also I wanted to make some kind of intimate thriller because I think that when you have to go that way and, you know, each day gets you closer from the problem, there is a tension that I really wanted to share with the audience. Mm-hmm. And so how to make that silence be a tension, you know? So you have right. to use and work with every dimension of what a movie can be. So the sound, the breathing, the frame, and there is not much music in the movie, but still, you know. Mm-hmm. So yes, I worked on all those dimensions in order to keep the tension.
Yeah, speaking of the music, obviously I noticed score a lot because I'm a composer.
What did you think about the score?
I thought that it worked brilliantly for the picture. You know, there was a lot of prepared piano and some woodwinds, and it mm-hmm. felt like this kind of ticking clock at times, which sort of just reinforced, you know, what she was experiencing in her body. It's like every single day that goes on and she's pregnant and doesn't want to be. And it's, you know, challenging the future that she sees for herself, because like you said, all of those elements coming together, the sound, the space, the silence was really crucial for how the story unfolds. Mm-hmm. But as a director and a screenwriter, I was curious, how do you or do you think about music when you're writing?
I wanted something very precise. I wanted music that was not musical. I wanted something that could sound like sentences. And I really wanted to work with the Galperin's brother, the composers, because I would always listen to their work with Diaghilev, the movie Loveless. I called them quite early and they said, we are sorry, but we have no time. And I, as I am a bit stubborn, I edited the movie with Géraldine Mangenot, with the editor. We edited the movie with the music of Loveless. And at the end of the process, she knows the Galperin's brother, Jardine, and she called them back and said, hi, we tried your music on the movie and it really works. Would you consider looking at it? And then you tell us what you think. And Evgeny was not happy. He said, I hate people to use the music that I've made for one movie to
something else,
edit
yeah.
another one. But I must admit that our music and her movie works together. So we're gonna do it. But it really was a battle. And I was so happy that we've made it work together because I really think that they were the right person to do the movie.
You know, I feel like so much of the film are these snapshots of her life and we're with her in these spaces for these short moments. Are you very specific about them as you're writing? Like in the script, do you kind of write these snapshots and figure out the pacing of the film that way? Or is how long is the time that you spend in a certain space kind of figured out on set?
The main thing that helps understand and do the journey with her was the length of every mm-hmm. shot. And that's something we really carefully think about with all the crew on set. If you keep it longer, if you make it, because it's very hard for the actress, the audience gets what she feels, you know? So you start feeling it in your own body. But if it's too long, then you become provocative. And that was not my purpose. I mean, if the movie is shocking, it's only because reality is shocking, not because I was trying to be shocking. So as I don't edit much because my every shot is quite long, you know, mm-hmm. I had in mind that I have to find the right lens on the set. And so we spend a lot of time working on that idea on set.
The camera is so often over her shoulder or behind her. We're kind of experiencing it through her lens, or like as if we're her friend and we're just right behind her through this, which made it so incredibly raw, like we're this presence with her the entire time. When did you make the decision to kind of have that sort of witness viewpoint?
My idea of that story was, let's try not to watch this young woman, let's try to be her.
Right.
And I really wonder if we would be able to be her, whereas we are women or men, mm-hmm. and not considering the period of time.
That's also such an incredibly compelling way to tell the story too, is, you know, it feels like it could be present day and these stories happen in present day. So the fact that it is a period piece, but you don't notice it based on the costume or, you know, the color or the landscapes or anything like that. It could very well be at any point in history because these issues are still so prevalent. And that was such a unique way to tell a story from that time period, which is not telling the audience it's of that time period. So it's just incredible.
You know, of course, in France, we have a law that allowed women to get an abortion, but I was thinking about all those different countries where it's not possible. And it's very interesting because when I started writing, lots of people asked, but why would you make a movie on that topic right now? You know, in France, you have the law. And I was like, okay, but let's consider that there is the rest of the world. And then while I was writing, there was something happened in Poland, you know, and the law changed. And on my way to Venice, it was Texas. So it made to the audience feel it's closer from us. But the movie is also about freedom in general, you know, and it's also about sexual freedom and pleasure and how she talks about it. And she doesn't talk about her feelings, she talks about desire. And for many reasons, I felt reading the book at first and writing then that she's some kind of a very modern and nowadays character. And I wanted to give that feeling to the audience because I had that feeling while reading.
Yeah, absolutely. That definitely comes across. It's such a powerful, strong character. And I think so many women can relate to her. I wanted to ask if you feel a certain responsibility as a woman to tell female stories. Is that something that you're conscious of, aware of, or you kind of gravitated towards this story because it was important to you? Or do you hope to continue to tell female stories?
I think it comes naturally. I mean, I really dig into my intimate journey to work and write. So it comes naturally to a point where I'll tell a story that maybe a man would not tell that way, you know. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I've been asked a lot about the female gaze. Mm-hmm. And I think we should consider the female gaze for what it is. It's important to notice that your gaze comes also from your gender. But it's also very important not to limit the gaze to the gender, because it would actually say that every woman would tell the story the way I did.
Right.
And I think we have many different gaze, and that makes it very interesting, because it also says that we have room and space for lots of female filmmakers. And my gaze comes from my education, my studies, my history, my roots, many things, and also my gender. So I think it's important to say it and say it out loud and say it again and again. You know, we need lots of female directors with lots of a singular journey and lots of different gazes, by the way.
Yeah, that's very well said. That's very true. Very inspiring. Well, Audrey, thank you so much for sitting down with me and talking about
Happening. Thank you. I would have loved to learn more about how you compose, by the way, but I'm very happy that you've made it to, you know, drink that tea together.
Indeed. Yes. Cheers. This is great. Great tea time. Cheers to you and congratulations again on your nomination.
Thank you so much.